So obviously this is the tree with the leaves, and here's the trunk with the roots down here. And I'll take you through what the different vignettes are. There's a scripture in Revelation that talks about the tree of life, and it talks about the leaves being for healing. And so we thought that was another very significant element that we wanted to incorporate in. So the leaves are kind of showing that. So underneath the leaf is a spoon, and that represents eating better. And so that is self-control also. So like we picked one word that describes like something really kind of super personal, another one that's kind of more like an overarching idea. And then this one is for health, which would bring joy, so that's the overarching idea. And this one is career, which brings purpose. And this one is legacy, which is a picture of Audrey's grandmother, which to her meant a gentleness. And her grandmother also had breast cancer. This one down here is gardening, and that's goodness. So she's found a love of gardening since all of this, which I've also enjoyed. This is cats, and it's companionship, which is also love, because they were a source of companionship for her during this thing. Mm-hmm. This is home, which is also peace. This one is friendship, and this is sort of a picture of us, which is also kindness. Throughout her time of finding out about having cancer and everything. This is time.
Which is patience.
Which is kind of like another gift that we've received these 10 years. And this one corresponds to her faith and belief in Christ. So.
Yeah, and these all, like we were talking about, they're all universal concepts, but then they also have particular meaning for the journey that I was on and how Sarah was supportive. And just to show you here on the back where the little bra is made, there's a little tag and it has S and A, which is Sarah and Audrey. And for me, it was going through treatment and the immediately, like the day I think I was diagnosed, and I called, and Sarah at that point, I was living in Charlotte and Sarah was living in Florida. And as soon as I called, and it was kind of a week long process, because you go through finding, you know, I found a lump, and then you go to your general doctor who says, yes, I want you to go and get a specific, you know, mammogram. And you think, and luckily she did a diagnostic, even though she thought, she was like, I don't think it's cancer, but let's just send you just to be sure. And then when I got there, and I went to a wonderful center in Charlotte, they were saying, let's go ahead and do some other tests. And what I realized later was that they already knew. And yet, because they had seen it so much, but they couldn't say anything until they had a full diagnosis. So they were like, let's go ahead and do a biopsy. I'm like, yeah, sure, you know, no clue. And then that was a Wednesday, and they said, we need you to come back on Friday and bring your husband with you. And I was still like, okay, sure, you know. And so we got the diagnosis on that Friday, and it was, you know, it was a process where you sit for a couple of hours, and then you start calling everybody and telling them. And so as soon as I called Sarah, my best friend, who now it's been 30 years, so at that point it had been about 20 years being my best friend, immediately her and her husband were like, okay, we've got to find plane tickets and we've got to fly you up for the week or whatever. So she walked through, because at that point you're going through second opinion, you're seeing numerous doctors and just trying to figure out a plan. Given how advanced my cancer was and how close it was to the skin, I had to go through my chemotherapy first. And so they were trying to schedule surgery to put in a port and make sure that this was the best plan. And so you're kind of running on two tracks. And so I started chemotherapy right away, then I was going to have my surgery, and then I was going to have my radiation. And so it was really amazing to have so much support. I can't imagine people not going through it without that. And it was also, I mean, it was a huge step of faith. It was to believe that no matter what, being diagnosed stage 3B, knowing that it was already in my lymph nodes and could potentially spread, was either way, there was going to be a healing. And we just didn't know if I was still going to be here. And so it was just watching a lot of friends come into town, a lot of support, and like her and a group of friends down in Florida, excuse me, where we used to live, they had this sewing party, and they made all these scarves and things for me to send up. And I mean, it was really, you know, you look back on it and you're just like, wow, that was really neat. I mean, the cancer wasn't neat, but but the process and the support. And I was surprised when we were walking through it. Sarah came up and we went to this thing where you're essentially, they tell you have to throw away all your makeup because you can't get any kind of infections. And you can go to this day that they sponsor where they bring all this makeup in and help you feel good about yourself and teach you like 10 ways to tie a scarf. And what I was surprised about was a woman there who, even though she had a family and a husband, she didn't really have the network. I had an amazing church that supported me. I had amazing friends, you know, and we're walking through this. And, you know, she's talking about going to pick her kids up from school and after her chemo treatment. And we were like, whoa, time out. Somebody didn't explain something to you, which is they pump you full of Benadryl. You're in there for at least 4 hours getting your chemo treatment. And you cannot drive after this is over. So you are going to have to get someone to go and pick up your children. And she was like, I don't even know who that would be. And we were trying to help her brainstorm someone who could do it. And that's just another realization, like, wow, the support I had walking through it. And I was thinking, you know, the doctors, I think, are so used to it, and the nurses. It's like, somebody really needs to kind of talk about some logistics for what that process is like. But, yeah, so then from that, coming out of the treatment after a year and having my hair grow back and starting to kind of see some normalization in life, I ended up moving to the Rock Hill area. And then years later, Sarah and her husband moved up here. We've decided that it'd be a great place to retire. We actually like Rock Hill. And so when that started happening, it was interesting to see all these different things in my life really develop through this 10 years. And you know, you look at me eating better because there's so many foodies around here in the community that really helped me to see that. And then you look at my health really improving and going from not being able to work very many hours to working full time. And this was interesting is that in 2014, I was able to take the South Carolina bar and start practicing law again and working with an attorney where we help families in the community with adoption. Here under this leaf was a photograph of my grandmother. Her name was Margaret, and she also had breast cancer while I was a child. She was actually treated and felt like they had a lot of success with that even back in the day. But she went on to actually pass from throat cancer, and she and I were very close, and that was very hard on me when she passed whenever I was 12 years old. And so to be able to honor her as part of this piece had a lot of personal meaning, but I hope that it'll also help others to think about their legacy and the people that have gone before us that have walked through a cancer journey that resulted in so much treatment that we have today to understand about getting our mammograms and going ahead and moving forward with what can be really difficult treatment, but I think can really bring us out on the other side. And then for me to pick up a love of gardening whenever I bought my home in the historic district. And so Sarah and I have been doing a lot of renovations of our place. And I had a cat who passed, who was always sleeping on me during chemo, but ironically got cancer and passed while I was in radiation. And so now I have some new cats that I've rescued here. And then just to see my friends just continue. There's a group of girlfriends called the Yayas, and we take trips together, as well as just developing new friends here who've been incredibly supportive through my healing. And then time, which is, I think, a pretty obvious one, just still having another 10 years and being grateful for each year after that. And then my faith really growing during that time. I remember when they thought that I had brain cancer towards the end of the treatment because I couldn't use the right words for certain things. And they said, well, we want to test you for brain cancer. And I remember before the doctor walked in, looking at my husband at the time and just saying, no matter what the diagnosis, God is good. I mean, you have to believe that by faith, as I saw so many people walking through the cancer. So even since that time, just seeing my faith grow. And so that's why it has personal meaning, but then we have the universal concepts through the tree of life. So that was, and it was interesting, I think, when we were making this, we were really reminiscing and realizing a lot of things about the past, even though we try to celebrate on October 23rd, the day I was diagnosed. We kind of had some good moments thinking through some of the things that happened. You know, and like the story about time and this clock being on there came out of a story when I was in radiation. There was an elderly man in my radiation. They schedule you every 15 minutes. And he loved to find old clocks and fix them. And so he would bring a clock to everyone who was going through treatment around his time. He brought them for all the staff. And you really get to know these people whenever you are walking through that. So yeah, there's a lot of